सालुंके सर, इफ यू कुड प्लीज स्टार्ट द रिकॉर्डिंग।
यस हुजा, वी आर स्टार्टिंग इट जस्ट 1 मिनट.
ओके, सो अ वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। वी आर स्टिल वेटिंग फॉर द स्टूडेंट्स टू जॉइन इन। सम ऑफ देम मे हैव देयर क्लासेस स्टिल रनिंग, सो वील एडमिट देम एज इन व्हेन दे जॉइन। एंड फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई थैंक अ गेस्ट फॉर वेटिंग सो पेशेंटली। सो विदाउट एनी फर्दर डिले आई वुड लाइक टू स्टार्ट द सेशन दिस मॉर्निंग। सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल अ वेरी वॉर्म वेलकम टू आर गेस्ट डॉक्टर दीपक माने सर। वी वेलकम यू टू दिस बीवीपी कॉलेज सर फॉर दिस वंडरफुल सेशन एंड द टाइमिंग दैट यू हैव गिवन अस। एंड टुडेज टॉपिक फॉर द सेशन इज गोना बी इंट्रोडक्शन टू डीप लर्निंग एंड इट्स एप्लीकेशन। एज वी ऑल नो दैट इट्स अ वेरी ट्रेंडी टॉपिक एंड विथ लोड्स ऑफ स्कोप फॉर अ फ्यूचर करियर एज वेल। एंड बिफोर स्टार्टिंग विद द सेशन आई वुड जस्ट लाइक टू गिव अ क्विक इंट्रोडक्शन अबाउट आर गेस्ट ऑफ ऑनर फॉर द डे। सो एज यू कैन सी अ गेस्ट ऑफ ऑनर मिस्टर दीपक टी माने सर, ही इज़ एसोसिएटेड विद JSPM कॉलेज ऑफ पुणे, कॉलेज ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग पुणे। एंड ही हैज़ एन एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ ओवर 16 ईयर्स। ही हैज़ पब्लिश्ड मोर देन 25 रिसर्च पेपर्स। ही हैज़ बीन पार्ट ऑफ एंड लेड द रिसर्च फॉर फंडेड रिसर्च। देन ही इज़ डन इज मास्टर ही हैज़ अ BE डिग्री इन इंफॉर्मेशन टेक्नोलॉजी एंड ही इज़ डन इज मास्टर्स फ्रॉम भारती विद्यापीठ डीम कॉलेज। ही ऑल्सो हैज़ अ PhD degree from SGGS Institute of Engineering Technology. Then he is also a reviewer for the IAES International Journal of Artificial Intelligence. He is reviewer of International Journal of Cloud Application and Computing and many more. So without wasting any further time, I would like if sir, I invite you to the stage and please if you could continue with your session, sir.
Yeah, thank you for the nice introductions. Yes, I am audible now.
Yes, sir, you are. Please continue.
Okay, and also whether my screen is visible.
Yes, sir.
Okay, good morning, students. Now I am here to tell you about the introduction about the deep learning and its applications. In my presentations, I will try to give you some details about what is deep learning, why we require the deep learning nowadays. Everyone is saying deep learning is very important. So we will see why deep learning is so important and what are the different applications of deep learning. And also I will try to tell you about the very important algorithms, that is the convolutional neural networks. I will tell more detail on that convolutional neural networks. It is the supervised deep learning algorithm. And finally, I will try to tell give you some case studies so we can understand the visualization of the CNN. When we are talking about the CNN is automatically extract the picture. So in this all these concepts I will cover by using the one case studies. Okay, so let's start with the basic questions in our mind. What is the machine learning, right? So everyone is saying, yes, machine learning is very important in artificial intelligence. Machine learning is a subset of artificial intelligence. But what is exactly machine learning? When we compare the traditional programming with the machine learning, what is the exact difference? Okay, there are two famous popular definition for machine learning. One is given by the Tom Mitchell and another one is given by the Samuel. Okay, they are saying the first definition of machine learning is we are providing the ability to our computer to think, take a decision without explicit program. So we are providing the ability to our computer to take a decision without explicit program. And another definition is we are improving the performance on particular tasks with examples. Okay, we are improving the performance of one task with experience, with examples. Okay, so when we compare the traditional programming with machine learning programming, what is the basic difference? In traditional programming, we know the set of instructions, like it, we know the programs. Also, we are passing the input to that programs, means we do the data, right? So in traditional programming, we follow the instructions, and by using that instructions, we are trying to generate the output. So we know the input, we know the set of programs, and by using the input and programs, we are trying to generate the output. But in machine learning, okay, what is the difference? We know the input, we know the data, okay, we know also what is our output. So, okay, if I am taking the example of face recognition system, so I have an input as a person image, and also I know the what is the output of this input image. This is X person or this is a Y person. So I know the input, I know the output, and based on that input and output, we are trying to build our model. So we can compare these terms with the program in traditional programming. So in traditional programming, we know the input and programs, and we are trying to generate the output. And in machine learning, what we are doing, we know the input, we know the output, and based on the input and output, we are trying to generate the program or model, right? So when we compare these machine learning terms, deep learning terms, AI terms, so there are similar terms in the market. Okay, so on screen you can see machine learning is a subset of artificial intelligence, deep learning is a subset of machine learning, and side by side we can also see the analytics and data science. What is that? We know that the objective of artificial intelligence, what is the objective of artificial intelligence? The machine can take a decision like as a human. So this is the main objective of artificial intelligence. To achieve this objective, there are number of machine learning algorithms in the market. Okay, I can say that more than 10,000 algorithms are presently we are using to achieve the goal of AI. Like as we are using the supervised machine learning, where we are using the labels to train my machine. Another category of machine learning is unsupervised learning, where we are using the unlabeled data to train my machines. Another category is reinforcement, right? So there are number of learning techniques like as a super vector machine, decision tree, neural network, random forest, k nearest neighbor, k means. Okay, so there are number of techniques are available in the machine learning, right? But what is a deep learning? Deep learning is not a new concept. This is not a new train. Okay, this is just extension of a neural network. We can say the out of this number of machine learning technique, deep learning is one type of machine learning technique, which also help us to train our model. Okay, to achieve the objective of AI. Right? I will tell you more about the deep learning. And side by side, every applications we require the data. Without the data, we can't do anything. We need to visualize the data to take a proper decision, to find out the useful information, to find out the hidden patterns from the data. We require the concept of data science. Nowadays, everyone is saying the data science, but at back end, deep learning, machine learning, AI is already there. And in every applications, we require the data. Without data, we can't do anything. Nowadays, why this deep learning is so popular? There are many reasons. First reason is big data. We know that the concept of data warehouse and big data. We know that the big data means we can explain the big data in three terms, right? Velocity, variety, and variety, right? So when we are talking about the latest big data, every application nowadays using the big data, handling the big data, to big data analysis itself is one challenge. Whatever the traditional machine learning algorithms are there, they are unable to handle the big data efficiently, right? To handle the big data is a challenge in the market. So the big challenge related to handle the big data, new techniques came into the market, and deep learning is one of them. Second reason why we learn the deep learning. when we apply the traditional machine learning algorithms, like as a support vector machine, decision tree, random forest, k nearest neighbor, all machine learning techniques, when we apply it on the big data, when we increase the data size, their performance decrease. And when we compare the deep learning techniques, when we increase the data size, the performance is also increased. So when we compare deep learning with the older traditional machine learning techniques, we can say the deep learning techniques are efficiently handles the big data. Okay, so we are using the deep learning to handle the big data. This is another reason. First is a big to handle the big data, also we increase the performance as compared to the traditional technique. Another very important reasons, now when we see the trends, okay, on Google Trends, we can see the trends of techniques, right? So when we see graph of deep learning, okay, you can see here after 12, okay, 2012, the graph of deep learning is different. Okay, many job opportunities in deep learning. Why? Because deep learning required the computational power, and after 2009, okay, NVIDIA launched the GPUs, graphics processor unit based systems. So by using the GPU, we can easily run the neural networks or deep learning algorithm. So after 2012, okay, deep learning is so popular. If I am taking the example, okay, I hope you already familiar with the largest image data set in the world, that is the ImageNet. Okay, and if we see the winning architecture from 2012 to 2019, okay, all winning architecture is based on the deep learning. So we can say to handle the patterns, to handle the big data, deep learning is so popular. The many researchers like as Geoffrey Hilton, who is the professor in Toronto and also working with the Google. Okay, another main researcher in this deep learning is Yann LeCun. Okay, he's working with the Facebook, and also another well-known researcher in this era deep learning is Andrew Ng. Okay, who is working in Baidu, right? So we can say the different researchers are taking their interest to work in this era. Okay, IBM launched a True North chip which contains the neurons more than human brain. So hardware is not a big challenge. What is the challenge? How we can implement, how we can create one program to handle the big data. Now when we compare the machine learning with the deep learning, what is the basic difference? We have discussed about the what is difference about traditional machine learning with the traditional programming with the machine learning. Similarly, when we compare machine learning with deep learning, okay, what is basic difference? Machine learning take the data, try to find out the features and pass these features to the machine learning model, and machine learning model trying to generate the output. Okay, so this is the traditional steps how we can do the training in machine learning. Okay, when we compare machine learning with deep learning, you can see on a screen, deep learning directly take the data, okay, without any features. Okay, we apply deep learning technique directly on the input. Input may be, okay, image, any kind of data, okay, speech, audio, video, image, any kind of data, we can say the input, deep learning technique directly apply on that input and trying to generate the output. Okay, so we can say what is the size of data required to train the machine learning and deep learning. Deep learning required the size of data set large, as machine learning required the small data. But when we compare with the time, machine learning takes less time as compared as the deep learning, but okay, but deep learning is efficient on the big data. Okay, so number of algorithms related to machine learning are, yes, normally many algorithms in machine learning, but we can say there are less number of algorithms present in deep learning. Now next, yes, what is deep learning? Now what is exactly deep learning? Why it is so popular? Deep learning, okay, I already told you, deep learning apply on directly on the data, and the beauty of deep learning is to extract the features automatically. What is mean by features? When I am trying to recognize my face, okay, if for example, I am implementing a one project for the face recognition system. So before my training, I require the some features to identify the face, like as the nose, ear, hair. So I first find out the features from my face, and I pass these features to my machine to find out the proper output. So these are the features. Okay, for recognize any object, we require the features, right? When I am saying this is the chair, this is the table, how I can recognize? If I know the features of that particular object, based on that features, I can recognize easily. Similarly, when I am doing the training, giving the training to my machine, I require the features. In machine learning, this is a pre-processing task to extract the features. But in deep learning has the ability to extract the features automatically. So we are saying deep learning directly apply on the image. No need to calculate the features. Deep learning technique automatically extract the features. Okay. Another important importance of deep learning is, yes, deep learning is also referred as the depth of networks. Means what? When we compare the learning of human with learning of deep learning techniques, how we can learn? Dr. Hubrell has already given the theory how human can recognize the object. Okay. So if I'm taking the simple example, when I enter into the classroom, I can see the multiple objects simultaneously, and I can say this is the chair, this is the table, this is the pan, this is the tube. Multi object I can recognize simultaneously. How? What is the basic theory behind that? How human brain can recognize the multiple object? He first see the dot. We can say this is a pixel. When we compare pixels, we can see the edge. When we combine different edges, we can see the part of object. And when we combine part of object, we can see the whole object. So this theory of human brain, okay, this is already given by the Dr. Hubel, right? So based on this same theory, okay, some researchers are presented one architecture in which name is the deep learning. Okay, this architecture is totally based on the human brain. Okay, so this deep learning techniques also trying to learn with the different layers. First layer we can say the pixel, second layer we can say the edge, third layer we can say the part of object, and fourth layer we can say the whole object. So the same theory we are using the deep learning. So deep learning is automatically extract. Okay, so for that we require the number of layers in input and output. Okay, what are the inputs and outputs? Okay, I will explain in the further slides, but before that we will discuss. Okay, if deep learning is very popular, deep learning has ability to extract the features, if deep learning is handle the big data efficiently, then what are the applications? Okay, when we see the different applications in different domains, like as a pattern, any kind of pattern, okay, pattern classification, pattern recognition, so pattern, any kind of pattern, okay, related to the image, whether pattern is a digit pattern, whether the pattern is a face pattern, face image pattern, or any kind of image, right? Second is the NLP, in NLP, natural language processing, okay, any kind of text. when we are saying that language translator, I want to implement the applications English to Marathi, Marathi to Hindi. Okay, in machine translator, we are saying that this is the domain of natural language processing. Third domain is a computer vision. Where, okay, when I am saying the different applications is the I want to recognize the nameplate and vehicle type from the real-time video. I want to recognize the activity doing by the humans. Okay, so in on video, if I am doing something, okay, nowadays this era is very popular. Okay, so everywhere in the pattern in natural language processing or ADU. Okay, third last domain of deep learning is audio. Okay, where we are doing this audio classification, speech classification, recognition. So in this four domain, deep learning is so popular. Which four domain? First is a pattern, second is the NLP, natural language processing, third is a computer vision, and fourth is a speech or audio. If you are doing your project in this four domain, try to give the first priority to deep learning algorithm, because in this four domain, deep learning is so popular. Like as I can say the categories of applications in
Sir, you are not audible, Mani sir.
I think the guest is facing some
internet.
Sir, could you just repeat what you said in the previous slide, please? You were not audible. Yes, I think so. There was some internet lag. Could you just repeat what you said in the last slide, please? You can start from there.
Yeah. So what I am saying, yes, is it visible?
Yes, sir. Please come.
Okay, so what I am saying, if you are selecting your project in this four domain, first is a pattern, second is a natural language processing, third is a computer vision, and fourth is audio. So if you are selecting your project in this four domain, okay, give the first priority to the deep learning algorithms, because in this four domain, deep learning is so popular. Nowadays, we can say the self-driving car, this is the latest applications. We can say converting the 2D into 3D, handling the 3D images. Okay, so nowadays, okay, deep learning is so popular. Everyone is using these deep learning techniques in these applications, right? Self-driving cars. So you can imagine, okay, when we are saying the driverless car, okay, how it's work. When we are saying I hope you already familiar with the Watson machine, where they are at back end, they are using also the grid computing concept, where deep learning is also very popular. Okay, so when I categorize the application in different subcategory, like as on internet, in medicine, in media, in social network, entertainment, security, and autonomous machines, yes, everywhere we are using the deep learning. Like as a simple application, if I am saying handwritten digit recognition. Okay, handwritten digit recognitions means we are giving the training, okay, we are passing the input as an input image as a digit, and machine can recognize what type of digit in that image, right? So image classifications, speech recognitions, language translations, okay, language processing, semantic analysis, okay, and recommendations. These are the very, very interesting applications. Okay, also I put the link from where I put these slides. You can see more details on these applications, right? So when I am doing handling any kind of image, maybe the image is a handwritten digit image, may be the face image, may be the medical image, x-ray image. So any kind of image, when we are doing, give the first priority to the deep learning algorithm, because deep learning algorithms are so popular in patterns. Okay, another very famous area where is the gaming. Okay, and you know that Nvidia launched the GPU in 2009. Okay, also they use the GPU for the general purpose programming. So they also launched the different libraries. Okay, to do the programming by using the GPU, like as you know the TensorFlow, okay, PyTorch, okay, there are number of libraries they are launched by using the different languages. Okay, by using that languages you can do the programming for the gaming, like at the if you are familiar with the latest applications, okay, for a number of games we can implement by using the deep learning. In security sections, we can say the face detection, satellite imagery, or if I'm taking this one application, problem which is asked in the hackathon, that is a try to find out the terrorist vehicle from the satellite images. Okay, one statement asked in another hackathon, that is a head count detections. One applications related to the agriculture, like as air surveillance, crop detections. Okay, so number of applications, whatever which are asked in the number of hackathons, all they are based on these four domains only. Okay, so okay, give the priority to use the deep learning. Now I hope you familiar with the deep learning applications. Okay, everywhere. Okay, number of applications are there where we can use the deep learning techniques. Now how we can train the machine? This is the general model. Okay, this is the general model. We are taking the data, we clean that data, we are doing some pre-processing tasks on the data, we divide the data into the training samples and testing samples, and we pass these samples to our models, we train the models, okay, based on the train model, we pass the testing samples to the train models, and we are checking the performance, and based on that performance, we again improve our performance of our model. So this is the general steps to train the machines, right? Now we come towards our main concept. What is the deep learning and from where, okay, deep learning came into the market. Okay, deep learning is not a new concept. Okay, neural network, I hope you already familiar with the neural networks. Okay, what is a neural network? Neural network is one kind of machine learning techniques which is used to train our machine. Okay, like as a support vector machine, decision tree, random forest, k nearest neighbor, similar as we can say the neural networks are there, neural network classifier is there, which is used to train our machines. What is a neural network? What is the basic theory of neural network? Neural network is inspired from the human brain system. Okay, first remember one point. What is neural network? Inspired from the human brain system, okay, where every neurons, we can say the node, okay, for neurons we can say the node, every node take the input, doing the some calculations and pass these result to the next neurons. And okay, there are a input layer, hidden layer and output layer. What is the role of input layer? He take the input and pass through the hidden layers nodes. What is the role of hidden layers? Hidden layers do the some calculations and pass the output to the output layers, and output layer predict the output. Okay, so this is a basic theory of neural network. What neural networks are, the different layers are there, right? Input layer, output layer, hidden layers. And what is basic theory behind the neurons, neural networks? This architecture is inspired from the human brain theory. Okay, what is the human brain theory? One cell of this neuron, what is the working of this particular neuron? What are the parts of that neurons? On screen, you can see the one cell contain the cell body. Okay, when one cell connect to the another neurons, this is a synapses. When we are seeing the red point, this is the axon. Okay, these cell body take the input from the synapses and generate the output, and this output is passed through the axon through, okay, and this output can connect to the another neuron. So this is a basic theory of human brain. Based on this theory, researchers drawn one architecture of single neuron. Actually, neural networks contain the number of nodes. Node is nothing but the neurons. So to understand the whole neural networks, first try to understand the working of single neuron. What is a single neuron? We can say the single node. Okay, for single node in neural networks language, we can say this is a perceptron. What is the working of perceptron? Now you can see this is an input layer on screen. Also, you can see this is an input layer and Y is output layer. So we can say the X are there. X is the input. X vector is the input, and Y is my output, right? So in neural networks, we are using normally the label data. What is mean by label data? Means we are using the label with input, like as a what type of digit in that image. So I can say that the image is a 2. So I pass the label of 2 with this input image. Another image contains the 3 digit. So I pass the 3 label with that input image. So I can say the X1 is the input, X2 is the input, and X3 is the input. With input, we are passing the weights. What is the weights? Weights are the strength of this input. So we pass input through the node. Okay, what is the role of this cell body? What is the role of this node? Node contain the two hidden functions. One function is a net function or transfer function. What is the role of this net function? Combine the input like as x1 w1 plus x2 w2 plus x3 w3. So combine the input, we can say the net value, calculate the net value and pass this net value through the activation function. Okay, so this is a working of single perceptron. What is the working? Calculate the net and pass this net to the activation function. Okay, now on screen you can see that I have written the one activation function. This is a sigmoid activation function. There are number of activation functions. Okay, but for understanding purpose on screen, I have put the one activation function, that is a sigmoid activation function. So what is the working of single neuron, single perceptron, single layer neural networks? Calculate the net and pass this net to the activation function and generate the output. I hope you understood. Okay, so this is a layer where we can use this single layer perceptron. We can say the all logic gates, okay. I hope you are familiar with the AND gate, OR gate, right? So we can easily implement this all logic gates by using the single layer perceptron. On screen, you can see X1, X2, these are my inputs, and plus one is my bias, okay? I always pass this bias with the input because to take a proper decision, I require the bias, okay? So when I calculate the net and pass through the activation functions, I am generating the output. So by using the single layer perceptron, I can easily solve the AND gate. On screen, you can see I pass this AND gate value through this perceptron. By using these weights, you can easily solve this AND gate. Okay. Normally, okay, in our training, okay, we are not giving the exact value for weights. Okay, because when we are saying the label data set, we know the X, we know the Y, because we already discussed about the theory of machine learning. We know the input, we know the output. And by using the input and output, we are trying to generate the out model. Okay, so we know the input means X, we know the output means Y. So we know the X, we know the Y. We can't change the value of input, we can't change the value of output. So what is your hand? We must change the value of different parameters of weights. Like as a two normally parameters we are using, like as a, now on screen you can see the plus 20, plus 20, minus 30. These are the weights value. Initially I assign the random value for these weights, but when I train my models, when I might train my models based on their error. Okay, based on the there, I again change my weight. So based on the training, okay, based on the different iterations, I finalize my weight values. And these are the only parameters which value we can change. Okay, so try to understand. In neural networks, we know the input, we know the output. We can't change the value of input output. What is in our hand, whatever the values we are assigned to the weights, we change that values based on the error, okay, and we train the models. Now this is a single layer perceptron. Now when I'm talking about the multi-layer perceptron, what is a multi-layer perceptron? If you understood the working of single perceptron, single node, okay, so multi-layer neural network is nothing but the multiple neurons. In previous slides, we have seen the working of single layer perceptron, right? In this figure, you can see number of nodes are there. So if you understood the working of single neuron, the same working is here. What? Input layer is there, output layer is there, and in between input and output layer, there is a hidden layer. In previous slide, you can say input layer is there, output layer is there. There is no layer between the input layer and output layer. Input layer directly connected with output layer. So for that architecture, we are saying this is a single layer perceptron. In multi-layer perceptron, input layer is there, output layer is there, and in between input layer and output layers, hidden layer is there. Working of this network is same as the previous. What? The every node calculate the net, pass this net to the activation function, and output is passed to the next node. So this working is same. What is the only change? In multi-layer perceptron, we are using the hidden layer. We are using the number of nodes. If I am taking the simple application of multi-layer perceptron, you can see, okay, in this architecture, you can see the input layer is there, output layer is there, and in between hidden layer, we are using the two nodes. Working of this architecture is same as a single layer perceptron. We are calculating the net of first node, pass this node to the activation function. Like I can say the H1 is a first neuron in this architecture. H1 take the input of I1 and I2, and H1 calculate the net, pass this net to the activation function, and whatever the output of H1 pass through the O1 and O2. The same working for the H2. H2 take the input I1 and I2, calculate the net, pass this net to the activation function, and whatever the output from the H2 pass through the O1 and O2. So this is the simple working. If I'm writing the equation of all the nodes, okay, how we can find out the error and how we can change the weights. So in multi-layer perceptron, normally we are using the forward pass and reverse pass. In previous slides, whatever I have discussed, this is a forward pass. Forward pass means what? Whatever the input, I pass this input to the network and generate the output. This is my forward pass. But whatever I predicted my output, this is my predicted output. I compare my this predicted output with the actual output. What I am saying, whatever the input I pass through the network and whatever the output, I am saying this is my predicted output. And I know the actual output. I compare actual output with the predicted output. If some difference is there, I can say there is the error. When I compare predicted output with the actual output, if value is there, so I can say the error is there. So for minimize the error, based on that error, I need to change the value of weights. Because we already discussed, we can't change the input, we can't change the output. What is in our hand, we must change the value of weight. Okay, so by using the forward pass, we calculate the output. What is in reverse pass? We calculate the error with comparing the predicted output with the actual value. We calculate the error. If error is there, we change the weight with respect to the error. So this is the again we forward pass. So we are doing the same thing, forward pass, reverse pass, forward pass, reverse pass, till our expected output is not generated. So when I am theory of neural networks, okay, why I am telling you the theory of neural network? Because deep learning is not a new trend. this is a just extension of neural networks. To understand the deep learning, you must understand the working of the neural networks. So normally, what are the steps in neural networks? On screen, you can see initialize the weight randomly, feed through the forward pass and generate the output. Compare this output, predicted output, with the actual output. If error is there, adjust the weight based on that error. So this is the general steps how we can train the neural networks. Okay, initialize the weights, random weights, calculate the output, compare this output with the actual output. If error is there, then change the weight with respect to error and again retrain the models. This is the common theory to train the neural networks. On screen, you can see the some patterns. We can say there are two class of pattern, class 1 and class 2. When I initialize the values to weights, random initializations, we can see the decision boundary. Okay, this is a non-linear decision boundary. So this output is not correct. We can see this decision boundary can't classify the patterns into two class. So I retrain the model, I change the weight value, and then I retrain. Now we can see the another output. This line is also not correct. Error is there. So again I change the weight value, and again next decision boundary draw. You can see with respect to error, we are changing the weight value, and due to that change into the weights, we can see the different decision boundaries. Now this line is also not correct. This is also not correct. This is not correct. So we can say this decision boundary is correctly classify my pattern into the two class. What I did, initialize the values, weights, draw the decision boundary. If decision boundary is not correct, means error is there, again I change the value of weights and I retrain the model. Okay. So finally I got one decision boundary which classify the pattern into the two class, class 1 and class 2. I hope you understood the whole theory of neural networks. Okay. Now if you understood the theory of neural networks, now you can easily visualize what is a deep learning. Deep learning is the extension of neural networks. Means at one half part of deep learning technique, neural network is there. Multi-layer perceptron, for multi-layer perceptron, okay, we can say this is a fully neural networks. Okay, so what is a neural networks? We already discussed. There are number of layers. We can say the first layer is based on the pixels. Second layer, we can say that this is based on the edges. Third layer, part of object. And fourth layer is whole object. Okay, this is a general theory. Pixel, edges, part of edges, and whole object. So we are saying this is the multiple layer of presentations. This theory is similar as a human brain theory. So deep learning is so popular because of this deep learning architecture is similar as the human brain system. Human can recognize the multiple object simultaneously. Why? This is the theory, and the same theory is used in deep learning architecture. Okay. There are number of types of deep learning algorithms, like as a supervised deep learning algorithm and unsupervised deep learning algorithm. Okay, supervised means what? We are using the label to train the models. Okay, label data means supervised. Teacher is there. By using the teachers, we are giving the training. Unsupervised deep learning. Unsupervised deep learning means what? Some applications we don't need to the labels. Okay, if unlabeled data is there, and if I want to train that data, okay, I require the another type of techniques to train my machine. So supervised deep learning, some algorithms I have written. First is a convolutional neural network. Second is a recurrent neural networks. These are the example of supervised deep learning. Unsupervised deep learning, convolutional autoencoder, Deep Belief Network and Deep Boltzmann Machine, these are the examples under this unsupervised deep learning. Out of the number of techniques, one technique is so popular, that is a convolutional neural networks. This is a supervised one technique, that is a supervised convolutional neural networks. And in these presentations, I will tell you how these convolutional neural networks algorithm is extract the features automatically. Okay, because if you see this diagram on screen, okay, I divide this diagram into the three parts. First part is a multi-layer perceptron. First, last part, you can see the last part of this figure. This is a multi-layer perceptron. What is the role of multi-layer perceptron? Now you can see this first is an input layer. In middle layer is, we can say, the hidden layer. And last layer, we can say the output layer. So we have already discussed this network as a multi-layer perceptron, where we are using the forward pass and reverse pass. Forward pass, reverse pass. In multi-layer perceptron, we are whatever we have discussed the concept, this concept is all related to the backpropagation neural networks. And multi-layer perceptron at backend, which algorithm we are using, this is a backpropagation neural network, which use the forward pass and backward pass. Okay, so this is the theory of neural networks, right? So another part of this CNN architecture is a layers, okay? Convolutional layer and pooling layer. Actually, there are three layers in convolutional neural networks. One is a convolutional layer, second is a pooling layer, and third is a fully connected layer. Normally, three layers in convolutional neural networks: convolutional layer, pooling layer, and fully connected layer. What is the role of convolutional layer and pooling layer? These two layers are responsible to extract the features automatically. Okay, if you remember, when we compare the deep learning with machine learning, okay, machine learning required the features to train the models, and deep learning automatically extract the features. Okay, so this part, automatically extract the features, is done by these two layers, convolutional layer and pooling layer. Normally, convolutional layer is responsible to extract the features. Okay, I will explain all the three layers. And first part is the input image. Okay, we need to do some small part of pre-processing. I am not saying deep learning don't require the pre-processing. Yes, definitely we can do the small part of pre-processing, like as I want to convert the red RGB image into the grayscale image. I want to normalize the pixel values. We can say these are my pre-processing tasks in deep learning algorithm. In CNN, in input image, I pass through the convolutional layer, pooling layer, and fully connected layer. Based on these three layers, I can generate the output. This is the architecture of convolutional neural networks. Okay, scan this image in your mind. Okay, convolutional layer, pooling layer, and fully connected layer. Now we will see the working of convolutional layer. I told you, okay, convolutional layer is responsible to extract the features. Now, how this layer extract the features? Okay, whatever the input we are passing through this layer means what? In this convolutional layer, we are using the number of filters, we are using the number of kernels. Okay, if I am taking the simple example before understand this concept, okay, I have a three color: red color, green color, and blue color, right? When I mix green with blue, I can see the new color. Okay, I am taking the simple example. I have three color RGB. Okay, when I combine red with green, I can see the new color. When I combine green with blue, I can see the new color. Means what? When I combine something, two values, when I combine, I can see the different values. The same theory they have used in convolutional layer. You can see the input. I is nothing but the input image. Okay, like as the 7x7 is your input image. And this is a kernel. Okay, this is a kernel or filter. 3x3, 5x5, 7x7, 9x9. We can use the kernel size as per our convenience. Now, in this example, I have used the 3x3. Now, when I apply this kernel with this local respective field of input image, we can see the one value. So you can see this is not a matrix multiplication, this is a dot product. When I multiply 3 by 3 into 3 by 3, output is 1 by 1. 3 by 3 multiply by 3 by 3, output is 1 by 1, means this is a dot product. The same equation I have written on the screen. What is the role? This kernel is applied on whole image and we are generating the output image. We can say this is the input image and this is the activated input image. I is the input image, I into K is the activated feature map. Okay, when I apply the one kernel, but I don't know this kernel is identify the feature or not. I can't give the guarantee. So I can use the number of kernels as per my need. I can use the 16 kernels, I can use the 32 kernels, I can use the 28 kernels, right? So which find out the which feature I don't know. The general theory, okay, this is the one GIF image. How I can pass one kernel on whole image? Input image is there, okay. How I can pass, you can see one kernel is applied on whole image, okay. Pass this kernel through whole image and I can find out the activated image. So I can say this is the activated feature map, okay. So I can say the one kernel means one feature, but I cannot give the guarantee whether this kernel is identify the actual hidden feature. So we are using the number of kernels. We are using the number of kernels. So one, for example, on screen you can see input size is 28 by 28. I apply the how many kernels? 16 kernels I apply on this image. So I will get the 16 images. Okay, I just revise. Input size is 28 by 28, and when I apply the 16 kernel on this input image, one kernel, one image, like that 16 kernel, I will get the 16 image. But when we compare the size, okay, when we compare the size, 28 by 28, output size is 24 by 24. This is a simple formula. How we, what is the size of output layer after convolutional layer? Input layer minus kernel size plus 1, 28 minus 5 plus 1, that is a 24. So I can say the one kernel, I will get the one image, 16 kernel, I will get the 16 image. So we can say first kernel find out the one feature, similarly 16 kernels find out the 16 features from the same image. So we can say for one image, we can see the same image by the 16 angles. We can see the same image by the different 16 angles, we will get the 16 images. So now you can understood. Now you can understand how we can see the same image by the different angles. 16 kernels, n dimensional. We can see the same input by the 16 angles, right? How many convolutional layers you can use? As per your need, you can use the convolutional layer 1, 2, 3. When you see the winning architecture of ImageNet competitions, VGG16, okay, AlexNet, GoogleNet, they have used the number of convolutional layer as per their need. They have used the, they have customized this architecture. Sometimes they have used the kernel sizes 5 by 5, sometimes they have used the 3 by 3, sometimes they have used the 7 by 7. So this is a convolutional layer. Okay, what convolutional layer is input on input pass, okay, apply the different kernels on input and generate the different images, okay. So as per our need, okay, we are using the number of kernels. One image, in this example I apply the 16 kernel, so I will get the 16 images. Next layer is a pooling layer. What is the role of pooling layer? Pooling layer is just downsampling the image, reduce the size to, okay, reduce the some computations, calculations. So pooling layer is not so much importance, but sometimes this pooling layer is handling the overfitting concept. So we are using the pooling layer. What is the pooling layer? This downsampling the image means what? whatever the output of my convolutional layer, 4x4, so reduce this input into the 2x2. If I will get the 12x12, and when I apply the max pooling, I will get the 6x6. So half of the image on screen, you can see the if I am saying that this is the output of convolutional layer with size is by 4x4, but when I apply the pooling, okay, I will get the 2x2. There are two types of pooling: max pooling and average pooling. Now you can see the these 4 pixels, which is the maximum value we can put here. Okay, so we can say out of this 12, 28, and 12, what is the maximum value? 20. So I put these 20. Now next 4 pixels, 30, 0, 2, 0. So which is the maximum value? 30. So this is the maximum max pooling. Similarly, we can use the average pooling. But what is the role of pooling layer? Just reduce the size. On screen, you can see convolutional layer, apply the kernels on inputs and generate the activated feature map. What is the role of pooling layer? Just downsampling, just reduce the size. How he reduced the size? On screen, you can see the input size is 4x4 and output of pooling layer is a 2x2 when we apply the max pooling. Okay, so I hope you understood the working of convolutional layer and pooling layer, because these two concepts are responsible to extract the features. I will show you the one case study, okay, where you can visualize how this convolutional neural network convolutional layer is extracting the features. Now these two, if you understood the working of convolutional layer and pooling layer, now next part is very simple. Okay, what is the pooling layer? If I am saying the pooling layer is just downsampling the image, like as a output of convolutional layer is a 16x16, so output of max pooling is when I applied 8x8. Okay, so how many images in convolutional layer? We can say the 64 kernels I have applied, so 64 images I will get, but its size is exactly half of input size. Okay, so this is the working of pooling layer. The theory of convolutional layer, the architecture, the algorithm steps for convolutional neural networks are: take the input, pass this input to the convolutional layer and pooling layer, and whatever the output of pooling layer, we pass through the fully connected layer. And we already discussed about the theory behind what is the working of fully connected layer: input layer, hidden layer, and output layer, multi-layer perceptron. Okay, so first two layer, convolutional layer, pooling layer, are responsible to extract the features. Whatever the features we have extracted from the input image, we pass this input features. We pass these features as an input for the multi-layer perceptron, where multi-layer perceptron train our models. Okay. For visualization, on screen you can see input size is 28x28. I applied the three kernels. I applied the three kernels with size is 5x5. You can see first kernel find out the different features of 7. Second kernel find out the different features of 7. So we can say this is a Marathi 7 digit, right? So Marathi language 7 digit. When we apply the three kernels, we will get the three different images of 7. This is some visualization of convolutional layer. When visualization of pooling layer, whatever the output of convolutional layer, we pass through the pooling layer. What is the role of pooling layer? Just reduce the size. Okay, 24 into 24, it reduces into 12x12. So you can say three layers we pass through the pooling layer, so it just reduces the size of that image, which is helpful for overfitting. Okay, for visualization, for some more visualization, if I am saying this is my input image is a 7, I pass through the different kernels and finally I will get the 30 activated feature maps. So you can see here all these features, okay, all these images are related to the 7. So I can say this first image of 7 is also, I can consider this the first feature to recognize the 7. Second image is also second feature which I can use to recognize the 7. So all 30 image, I can say these are the 30 features I can consider to recognize the same one. Just compare, if I am asking you how many features we can consider to recognize the 7 digit. Okay, as a human, we can say we can find out the 4 or 5 features, maximum 10 features to recognize the features. But when I told the same thing to my machine for deep learning techniques, as per my need, this machine can recognize the features. Okay, so 30 features as a human we can't calculate, but machine can calculate by with the help of convolutional neural network. So deep learning, we are saying sometimes deep learning extracts some hidden features, and due to that hidden features we can recognize the same one properly, because different person are writing skill is different, right? So when we are saying the 7 digit written by the different peoples, the style is different. Due to that different styles, normal machine learning techniques unable to recognize that digit. But due to the hidden features, CNN easily recognize that 7 digit, because he has the ability, he already extracted the hidden features. So I hope you understood the whole theory of convolutional neural networks. I will discuss the one case study, okay, for the convolutional neural networks. Now I hope you understood, there are 3 layers of convolutional neural networks. One is a convolutional layer, second is a pooling layer, and third is a fully connected layer. Convolutional layer is responsible to extract the features, pooling layer is responsible to downsampling the image, and fully connected layer is responsible to give the training, right? So for case study, okay, handwritten digit recognition on image input size, we can say that this is the input size, this input image contains the 2. What is my expectation from my machine learning model? It generates the output label is a 2, because we know that 2 is a one type of digit. How many digits? 0 to 9. There are 10 classes as output. Okay, so I can say input image. Input image is a 17 by 17. So we convert this input image into the pixels. So you can say that there are total 256 pixels in that image as an input. So I pass the 26 pixel values to the machine learning model, generate the output. Output is in how many classes? Out of 10, 0 to 10. Out of 10, 2 is one class of output. So we can say the output, how many classes? 10 classes. So how many pixels as the input? I convert the input image into the pixels. So for example, 250 pixels are there. I pass the 256 as an input to my machine learning model and trying to generate the output out of these 10 classes. So this is a general theory. And what is this machine learning model? This machine learning model, F, whatever the function I'm using, pass the 256 function to the machine learning model, trying to generate the output. This is my deep learning functions. When we taking the examples, okay, for your understanding, I put these slides, okay. Marathi digits, if you are creating your own data set, normally English data set is easily available. Marathi data set is not available. If you want to create your own data set, this is the one theory, how I have created my Marathi numeral data set. This is the one slides, okay. I put all the characters on the one page. I convert this image into the grayscale. I apply the different transformation on that image, like as a scale, okay, skew images, or okay, I rotate the angles, and based on that I created the numeral data sets. And when I pass this data set to the convolutional neural networks, on a screen you can see that this is a architecture. Okay, input image, I did some part of pre-processing, converting this input image into the grayscale. I pass this grayscale image through the convolutional neural networks, where convolutional layer is there, pooling layer is there, everywhere we are using the actuation functions. In one slide I have discussed the sigmoid actuation functions. Here I have used the ReLU, rectified linear unit. Okay, so convolutional layer is responsible to extracting the features. Whatever the extracted features from this convolutional layer and pooling layer, I flatten this image and pass this output of pooling layer as an input for my multilayer perceptron. By using the multilayer perceptron, I predict my input out of this 0 to 9 class. So this is my architecture. This is my architecture, right? Now, when I use the convolutional layer, now visualization of convolutional layer, last part of my presentations, okay, like that first input image, okay, you can see the 7 is the input image, which size is 28 by 28, where I applied the 16 kernel, which size is 5 by 5. 5 by 5 means what? 5 pixels. 5 by 5, there are total 25 pixels. Okay, so when I pass the 16 kernel on the input image, you can see the 16 output. So I can see the these 16 images for the same input image. For one, I created the 16 images. Again, I applied the second convolutional layer where I have used the 32 kernel. So when I apply 32 kernels on convolutional layer one, I will get the 32 activated feature maps. So I can say these are the 32 images for the same 7 digits. Again, if when I apply 64 kernels on this convolutional layer 2, I will get the 64 images. I can say this is the 64 features of this 7 digit. So now you can imagine, for one 7 digit, how many features I have calculated? 64 features I have calculated, and I can use these all 64 features to recognize the 7 digits. As a human, we can't find 64 features for the one digit, but machine can find, CNN can find, okay? So all these 64 features, 64 images, which size is 16 by 16, we can consider as a features, pass through the pooling layer. What is the role of pooling layer? Downsampling, 16 into 16, converting into the 8 by 8. Okay, so here I have used the max pooling, right? So we can say the downsampling, image size, reduce the image size, 16 into 16 into 8 into 8. So this is the output of pooling layer, just visualization, okay? So all these 64 images as a features, I pattern this image and pass these features to the multilayer perceptron, where multilayer perceptron take these features and generate their output. Multilayer perceptron, we know that input is output of pooling layer. Dense layer means what? This is the output of hidden layer, and this is output of output layer, where I have used the SOFTMAX classifier. So out of 10 classes, 0 to 10, this image contain the 7. Okay, this image contain the 7. So you can see the output of SOFTMAX classifier. The output is also 7. So this is a just visualization. This is a just visualization. When we put this result in your paper, okay, try to put your result by using the different parameters. Okay, performance measurement parameter, like as a confusion matrix, classification report, precision recall, okay, specificity, ROC curve. There are number of ways we can put our results. In my presentations, I have taken the confusion matrix. By using the confusion matrix, we can put your output results, whatever your accuracy you will get, you can put as in the confusion matrix. In my implementation, I got a 94% accuracy. So I put this result into the confusion matrix. Now, this is related to the multiple Marathi numerals. Okay, if you want to do some handwritten digit recognitions, standard MNIST data set is available on internet, which contain the 70,000 samples, 60,000 for training and 10,000 samples for the testings. You can download and you can also implement the convolutional neural network by using the MNIST data set. There are popular libraries. Normally we are using the popular libraries by using the Python. Python is very popular for the deep learning algorithms. Okay, where tense keras we are normally use TensorFlow libraries is specifically developed for the deep learning applications. Panda we can use for the different operations related to the data set. Import the data set, read the data sets, we can use the Panda library. NumPy library we can use to perform the different numerical operations. And if you want to put the result into the graph, you must use the matplotlib library from the Python. So these are the some libraries which are very popular to implement the deep learning. Okay. Another different framework is also available if you want to implement in C++ language for convolutional neural networks. You can use the Torch. If you want to implement the convolutional neural network by using the MATLAB, you can use the MAT convolutional net. If you are implementing the deep learning algorithm by using the Java, okay, you can use the deep learning 4J library. Okay, if you are implementing, okay, by using the Python, yes, Keras TensorFlow is a very popular library to implement the deep learning algorithms. Okay, so this is the small part of deep learning. I hope you understood the basic concept of deep learning, why we are using the deep learning. Okay, there are main two reasons why we are using the deep learning. Deep learning handles the big data efficiently, and deep learning has the ability to extract the features automatically. So due to these two reasons, main two reasons, we are using the deep learning. And where we can't use the deep learning, if we are saying the data is not related as a image, spatial patterns, then yes, definitely we can't use the CNN properly on that data. So this is as a summary. And also we have discussed the different applications under the pattern, NLP, computer vision and audio. And if you want to go into details, okay, based on this theory, I have published my paper in elsewhere, okay, visualizing and understanding customized convolutional neural network for recognition of handwritten Marathi numerals. I have published my papers. This is freely available. Okay, you can download that paper, read the concepts. I mentioned all the concepts of neural networks. And you can start your implementations. Till if you have any questions, you can contact me anytime on my email dtman@gmail.com. So with this word, I stop here, and I hope you understood the concept of deep learning, one algorithm of convolutional neural networks, and also we have seen the one case study for the handwritten digit recognitions. Now the some next 2 to 3 minutes, okay, the open session for the question answering. You can ask any questions related to the CNN. Thank you.
Yes, thank you so much for that wonderful session, sir. Yes, any students would like to come forward and ask questions to sir, they can please come forward. Or you can, if you want to ask sir personally, he has shared his email ID with you. So you can even contact him personally, and if there are no questions at the moment, which I'm sure because the session was very well explained, sir, and I'm pretty sure all the doubts of the student might have gone clear as it is. And yet, if any students have question, I'm sure they'll definitely contact you. So I think, sir, I'll conclude the session, and I first of all would like to thank you once again from the entire BEP family, the Department of Computer Engineering, on behalf of our HOD, Uday Patkar sir, Bala ma'am, sir, we really thank you for coming in here today, and in fact giving us more of your time than we actually asked. Sir, thank you so much, sir, and to take out this busy schedule and help us understanding the not just the introductory part, but I'm sure basically the student have really understood the deep learning as a subject as a whole from your today's informative session. And I really thank you, sir. Thank you for coming in. And I hope we get in touch with you more often in the future as well. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. Any parting words from your side, sir?
Also, yes, I am thankful to Patkar sir and Kukum madam to invite me to share my thoughts on deep learning. Yes, thank you for giving me the opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, yes. Thank you very much, sir. You have elaborated entire deep learning concept in such a short period of time. It was not expected from our side because it needs a lot of time to explain each and every concept one by one. And you did it so nicely in such a short time. So really thank you, and we will of course reach you whenever we will need you or need again in the future. And one more thing, I will contact to you for latest research topics, like latest projects, so that these B students can choose if they want. Yes, in the machine learning and deep learning concept. So if you have the list of project, you can share right now. Or in future, you can share me on my Gmail or whatever. Yeah, so that we can provide it to the students.
Yeah, ma'am. Sure.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Yes. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir, once again.
Thank you, Dr. D.T. Mane, sir. You have given your valuable time for all the our students, and thanks again, sir. Okay.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much once again, sir. And I thank all the participants who had joined with us today. I thank our HOD for coming in, and all the teachers to professors to be here with us today. And now I declare the session as concluded, and you all may leave the session now. Thank you so much. Thank you.